Sorry for the delay of some few minutes, as I was having some adjustments here because the orientation of the room has changed a bit. So in the last class we have seen about the stator and one kind of rotor of alternator, okay, salient pole alternator we have seen. So today we will be looking into non-salient pole rotor, okay, and other aspects of the alternators, okay. So we'll see second type of rotor, non-salient pole or cylindrical rotor. Or cylindrical rotor. So in the previous case, in the salient pole rotor, the poles were projected outside from the central magnetic wheel, heavy magnetic wheel. The poles were projecting outside, but in case of non-salient pole, there will not be projecting poles. Okay. And we have seen that the salient pole alternator cannot be used for large speed applications because of mainly because of the projected poles and the large diameter. Okay, with that, what will happen is, with large diameter, large centrifugal forces will occur, peripheral speed will be more, large centrifugal forces will occur. Therefore, there may be a tendency of the poles coming out of the fixation. So to avoid that, what we are doing is, we are having a separate construction for the large speed applications. Okay, so this non-salient pole motor is also known as cylindrical rotor, or the alternators that use this kind of rotor are called turbo alternators. Okay, or turbo generators. Okay. We know what you mean by turbo is high speed application. Turbo is very high speed. Okay, so the generators that use non-salient pole type of rotor are called turbo alternators or turbo rotors. Okay, so this is of solid cylindrical structure made up of laminations. Okay, it is made up of laminations. This is the shaft. Okay, these two are also having slip rings. Okay, so this is also having slip rings. The purpose why I will be drawing these diagrams online in the class, because you should know how to draw, because in the exam you should draw with your hands physically. So you should be knowing how to draw the diagrams. For that I will be drawing in front of you in the class, or else I would have simply shown you an image. Okay, so this is the rotor like that. Okay, so you should be knowing how to draw the diagram, okay, in a proper way. So for that I will be drawing along with you. So this is the cylindrical rotor. Okay. So this cylindrical rotor will be having some of its part in the core slotted. Some of the part in the core will be unslotted. Okay. So we will be placing the field winding. Say like I wound the field winding on the salient pole, I will be placing the field winding inside these slots. So these conductors indicate the field winding. I have sent you a few images to the class group which clearly indicate the salient pole type rotor, non-salient pole type rotor, even the stator. Okay, you will get a complete idea. You please go through those images. Okay. So now this field winding will be placed in the slots. Okay. And the unslotted part of the rotor core. See, this is rotor core, field core, okay, or rotor core. These are field winding. These are field windings. Okay. So these are supplied with, these are given with 220 volt or 110 volt DC. Again, we will be having two slip rings. And brushes. So these are slip rings. And these are carbon brushes. Okay. So 220 volt DC is given to the brushes. From brushes it will move to connected to slip ring. From slip ring it will be connected to the winding, and the unslotted part of the rotor core will form the poles. So this will be north. I will rub this all extended part. This is how the cylindrical rotor looks like. So this will be north. If this is north, this will be south. Then it will be north, this will be south. If this is south, north, south, north. Adjacent poles will be having opposite polarity. Okay. So when I provide the 220 volt DC supply to the field winding or 110 volt DC supply to the field winding, that field current will be flowing through all these conductors. And these conductors will form the magnetic field, and this non-slotted part or unslotted part will form the poles. Okay. So in case of salient pole, the poles were projecting outside, but whereas you can see there is no projection of the poles here, the rotor structure looks like cylinder, solid cylinder, but obviously made up of laminations. Okay. So because there is no projection of the poles, because there is no projection of the poles, I can operate this rotor at very high speeds. Because there is no fixation, the slots are punched out of the solid block itself. Therefore, because there are no external fixations to the rotor part, I can make this rotor run at very large speeds. So the speed at which rotor runs is around, it will be around 1000 to 3000 RPM. Because these are running at very large speeds, this type of rotor is known as turbo rotor or turbo alternator. This will be having large length and small diameter. This type of rotor will be having large length and small diameter. Because whenever any machine, rotating machine, has to be operated at large speeds, then the diameter of that rotor should be less. If the diameter of rotor is more and then still I am operating at large speeds, then large centrifugal forces will occur at the periphery of the rotor, and those centrifugal forces may result in coming out of the conductors out of the slots, or loosening the binding wires, or there will be flyout of the conductors. So which is always hazardous for the physical health of the machine. So that is the reason. Okay, so this kind of machines are with large length and shorter diameter. So the application of salient pole machine, what I told, was in hydroelectric power plant, because in hydroelectric power plant the speed at which turbine rotates is very less. It is around 300 to 600 or 700 rpm. Okay, then this kind of rotors are used in steam turbines. Okay, these are used for steam turbines. I think you have studied turbines in the previous semester. You know that if the gas turbines are to be operated at their higher efficiencies or their highest efficiencies, then they should be hit with a large or we can say a very high pressurized steam. Okay, if I have to get the maximum efficiency out of the steam in the energy conversion, then the steam must be highly heated, and it should be hitting the turbine blades at a very high pressure. So when the steam hits the turbine blades at high pressure, then turbine is bound to rotate at large speeds. So steam turbines, whether it is the steam turbine is running by the nuclear energy or geothermal energy or coal energy, thermal plants, whether nuclear plant, geothermal plant, or the thermal plant with the coal. Okay, all these will be using water to heat the water. We will be burning the coal, or we will be using the nuclear energy or geothermal energy. So that burnt, the heated water will convert it to steam, and that steam will be collected in a very high pressurized chamber. And when the steam exit from that high pressurized chamber, it will come and hit the nozzle, the blades of the turbine at a very large speeds. Okay, so in such cases, my rotor construction should be very strong to withstand large speeds. Hence, I will be using this type of rotor in case of steam turbine plants where the power generation is taking place. Okay, so hence this is called the turbo rotor or turbo alternator. Okay, it will be operating at a speed of 1000 to 3000 rpm. Okay, so there are few slots. The number of slots are very few on this. Okay, number of slots are very few on this. So the slotted part will carry the field winding, and the unslotted part will form the poles. And because the air gap between the stator and the rotor is minimum here. Now when I place the stator above this, so this is the stator with so many number of slots. Okay. So you observe the air gap between the rotor and the stator. It is minimum and is uniform throughout the diameter and throughout the length. Therefore, the noise of operation is also very less. So these are less noisy. Less noisy due to uniform air gap. These are less noisy due to uniform air gap. So these are the features of the non-salient pole or cylindrical or turbo generators. So when I this is the non-salient pole rotor. Okay, north is there. Okay, this is the non-salient pole rotor. How it looks like? I think white background, white. I will come in between. Yeah, I hope now it is clear. So this is the non-salient pole rotor where the slots are punched. These slots will carry the windings which will form the field coils. These slots will carry the winding which will form the field coils. These field coils, when carry the rated field voltage. Okay, when these field coils carry the rated field voltage, then these will create the poles here. So if this is north, this is south, this will be north, this will be south. If this is south, this is north, this will be south, and this will be north. Okay, so when I provide the mechanical energy to the rotor, and when I fix this rotor inside the stator, this is how the machine looks like. Okay, so this is how the machine looks like. You can observe, the machine will look like exactly like this when the rotor is placed inside the stator. Now suppose I have a conductor placed in the armature. This is armature. Okay, this is armature. Okay, I have a conductor placed in the armature coil. Now when the rotor is placed inside the stator, when the rotor is placed inside the stator, okay, and when the rotor starts rotating, okay, the flux is cut by the armature conductor. The flux is cut by this armature conductor, and an EMF is continuously induced in the rotor. Okay, so when the rotor rotates in the armature, and the rotor rotates in the armature, okay, an EMF is, sorry, when the rotor rotates in the generator, okay, the flux is cut by the armature conductor continuously, and an EMF is induced in the conductor continuously as long as there is rotation of the rotor. The moment rotation stops, rotor EMF, sorry, the armature induced EMF or generated voltage becomes zero. Okay, so even when there is rotation and if there is no field current into this, then also EMF induced is zero. So what I need is, as per the Faraday's law, change in flux and the conductor, but first I need to provide the flux. The flux is provided by the external DC source, then change in flux is provided by the rotation of the rotor or magnetic field. Then the changing magnetic field is linking to this conductor, and an EMF is continuously induced in this conductor. Okay, this is the construction of alternator or synchronous generator. Okay, so this is all about the construction of synchronous generator. So next part is working principle. Working principle already I explained. Okay, working principle, first I actually explained working principle, then we went for construction. So working principle, okay. So this working principle is simple, Faraday's law. Okay, it is this Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. So a flux is created in the field by by 220 volt or 110 volt DC in the rotor part. Okay, then magnetic field is created, a steady magnetic field is created in the rotor part between the stator and the rotor in the area. And when the kinetic energy is given to the rotor starts rotating. Therefore, the change in flux is experienced by the armature conductor, and hence an EMF is induced in the armature conductor. That is the principle of operation of alternator or synchronous generator. Okay. Then next is frequency of induced EMF. Frequency of induced EMF. frequency of induced EMF. Okay. So, first we should see what is the induced EMF. Okay. Now let us consider. Let us take one conductor in armature. One conductor in armature and two poles in field. Okay, so there is one conductor in armature and there are two poles in the field system. So let us take the armature is having only one conductor and we have two poles. In the field system. Okay. Now to this I will be providing the rotation, okay, angular velocity. Okay. Now we know that when the complete in one complete revolution this conductor will sweep one north pole and one south pole. In one complete revolution this conductor will sweep one north pole and one south pole. Okay, so with a two pole magnetic field in one revolution the EMF induced in a conductor is one cycle. One north pole will generate one half cycle, second south pole will generate one half cycle. Because of the opposition in the polarity, suppose any EMF induced in the conductor is positive under the influence of north pole, the EMF induced in the conductor under the influence of south pole will be negative. Okay, it is by default because of the nature of induction and the direction of change in the direction of magnetic field. So by Fleming's right hand rule I can give the direction of EMF induced in the conductor will be opposite. Okay, so this already is been seen in the generation of AC. Okay, so in one cycle, sorry, in one revolution when there are two poles the EMF induced in the conductor is one cycle. Now if the number of poles are four, now if I have four poles N and S, then each pole will induce half cycle. It means there are four poles, the EMF induced in the conductor are two cycles in one revolution. So one north pole will sweep half cycle, next south pole will sweep first negative half cycle, second north pole will sweep second positive half cycle, second south pole will sweep second negative half cycle. So in that case for each poles in one revolution half cycle is induced in a conductor. So number of cycles induced in one revolution in one conductor is always half the number of poles. Okay, so if number of poles are 2, number of cycles induced is 1. If number of poles are 4, number of cycles induced are 2. If number of poles are 6, number of cycles induced are 3. So each set of pole, okay, so each set of pole, so this is the magnetic field. Okay, so each set of pole will induce one half cycle. Okay, so sorry, each set of pole will induce one cycle. Okay, one north pole and one south pole will induce one cycle, next south and next north will induce another cycle. So number of cycles induced in a conductor in one revolution is always P by 2. Okay, number of cycles induced in one revolution. Is equals to P by 2, where P is number of poles. Okay. Then, what is the time taken by one revolution? See, what is frequency? Frequency is cycles per second. Don't forget the fundamental definitions. Fundamental definition of frequency is number of cycles per second is the frequency. Okay, so I know how many number of cycles in one revolution. If I know what is the time taken for one revolution, then I will get the frequency simply by multiplying those two. Okay, now if capital N, N is speed of rotor, speed of rotor in RPM, in revolutions per minute. If N is speed of rotor in revolutions per minute, then time taken by or number of revolutions per second will be simply N divided by 60. So N is number of revolutions per minute. If I want per second, divide it by 60. That's it. Then number of revolutions per second, okay, that is RPS, revolutions per second. RPM is revolutions per minute. RPS is equals to N divided by 60. RPS is equals to N divided by 60. Okay. So now what is the frequency? Cycles per second. I have number of cycles per revolution is P by 2. Number of revolutions per second is N by 60. Multiply these two. I will get number of cycles per revolution into revolution by 60. Revolution will cancel, cycles per second will remain. Okay. Therefore, frequency of induced EMF is equals to cycles, number of cycles in one revolution multiplied by number of revolutions per second. Okay, so that will be equals to frequency of induced EMF F is equals to number of cycles in one revolution is P divided by 2 into number of revolutions per second is N divided by 60, which is equals to P N by 120. So F is equals to P N by 120. So this is one of the very important formula in power system. Okay, this relation gives us this expression gives us the relation between speed, poles and frequency. Okay, so now I will tell you why the diameter of salient pole rotor is more and non-salient pole motor is less. Okay, now the disadvantage of salient pole rotor is that I cannot operate that at large speeds. Why? Because this salient pole rotor is having non-uniform air gap. See that air gap, I will simply rub the unnecessary part here. See, the air gap between stator and rotor here is minimum, and the air gap between stator and rotor between the poles is maximum. This non-uniform air gap, this non-uniform air gap will create very huge amount of noise, very huge amount of noise. That is one case. Second case, these poles are fixed to the magnetic wheels. These are fixed to magnetic wheels. Because these are physically fixed to the magnetic wheel, the large speeds will loosen the fixation, and there is tendency that the fixations may get come out. That is second case. Because when any body starts rotating, the forces acting will be always radially outwards. That we call it as centrifugal forces. Okay, we know that. Okay, whenever the rotating body starts rotating, the forces acting will be always radially outwards. That we call it as centrifugal forces. Because of centrifugal forces, what happens? Large amount of mechanical forces are experienced by the pole faces. The forces which are created because of rotation will be pushing these poles outwards radially. Therefore, the fixation may start getting loose. That is the reason why I don't go for large speeds in the salient pole rotor. Because of that, the diameter is made large. That is the reason. Okay, it is not because diameter is large, I don't go for large speeds. Because I don't go for large speeds, diameter is made large. Why I should make large diameter? See here. Frequency is constant. In India, it is 50 Hertz. You use any number of poles, run machine at any speed. My frequency requirement is 50 Hertz. Okay, so PN is equals to 120 into 50. Okay, so this will be 6000. So PN, P into N should be equal to 6000. It is a constant. Now if I have to decrease the speed, I should increase the poles. If I have to decrease the speed, I should increase the poles. Now if I have to increase the poles, I will decrease the speed to half, then the poles will increase to double. Now I have to place 8 poles on this rotor part. Is it possible to place 8 poles here? No, I should increase the diameter. So because the salient pole alternators are rotating at very low speeds, 300, 400, 500 RPM. Okay, later the speed is boosted up, that is a different issue. Okay, so since the speed of the salient pole rotors are very less, the number of poles provided should be very large. So only I told in hydroelectric power plants, the number of poles in the generator are at least 16, 18, 20, 22 like this. Not less than 16 or 18. Okay, so see, if the number of poles, say 20 number of poles are to be placed on the periphery of the rotor, I should be using large diameter. This is why the diameter of salient pole rotor is increased. Why? Because speed is less, number of poles are more. What about the cylindrical rotor or non-salient rotor? I can operate cylindrical rotor at very large speeds. So in this case, P into N is equals to constant. Okay, whatever that value, it is a constant. Now when the speed is very high, number of poles can be very less. It will be either 2 or 4, not more than 4. In case of non-salient pole rotors, number of poles will not be more than 4. It will be either 2 or 4. If for 50 Hertz, I have to operate at, to obtain 50 Hertz, if the speed is 1400-500 RPM, number of poles will be 4. If the operating speed is 3000 RPM, which will happen, many a time the rotating speed of the gas turbine is nearly 3000 RPM. When the RPM is 3000, number of poles can be only 2. See, number of poles equal to 6000 by speed. 6000 by 3000, 2. Only 2 poles. There can't be 1 pole. Okay, there will be at least 2 poles. My minimum number of poles are 2. So, cylindrical rotor operates at very large speeds with very minimum number of poles. Number of poles are hardly 2 or 4, not more than 4. Okay, so this is the reason why the diameter of the salient pole is less, but the length is made large. Why? Because the complete volume of the machine depends upon the power output. If the power output is constant, my volume of the machine remains constant. When I decrease the diameter, I should make length large. Okay? Therefore, salient pole rotors are have large diameters and short length. Cylindrical rotors are having short diameter and large length. Why? My frequency should be constant. My frequency is a big guy which I have to take care throughout the operation of power system. Everything is controlled to make the frequency constant. And today, the frequency variation practically is so constant that it will vary from 49.98 Hertz to 50.02 Hertz. In the earlier days, before 2014, the frequency variation was around 2 Hertz, 48 to 52 Hertz. After 2014, it is 0.02. Okay, it is 0.02. Why? Because in 2014, it is not because of government, okay? In 2014, the India became single grid nation. All the grids were unified and entire nation is now today having only one grid. Because of that, there is a large stability in the frequency. Okay? If there is a good stability in the frequency, large amount of losses in the power network can be minimized. That is the biggest advantage. Okay, so this is the importance of frequency. Okay, so next is EMF equation of alternator. Okay, EMF equation of alternator or synchronous generator. EMF equation of transformer we have seen, is it? So the EMF equations of any machine will give the amount of EMF induced or amount of EMF generated, and also those EMF equations will give what are the quantities upon which the EMF induction is depending upon. Okay, so next is EMF equation. So we know that fundamentally the generator is operating on Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Okay, so let us see some nomenclature notations. Let Z be number of armature conductors per phase. Why? Because generally alternators or synchronous generators are three phase systems, okay, or three phase machines. Okay, Z is number of armature conductors per phase, P number of field poles, phi flux per pole in Webers, flux per pole in Webers, F frequency of induced EMF in Hertz, and N rotor speed in RPM. N rotor speed in RPM. Okay. So I have a conductor here. I have placed a conductor and I have say four poles. N, yes, N, yes. each pole is each pole is creating a flux of 5 Webers. So this flux is flux created per pole. Okay, so each pole, this north pole is creating a flux phi, this south pole is creating a flux phi, this north pole is creating a flux phi, and this south pole is creating a flux phi. So the total flux created by the entire number of poles are 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5, and each pole will create the same amount of flux, because the number of turns provided on the each pole is same. Okay, so the total number of flux, the total amount of flux created by the field system is always equal to number of poles multiplied by this phi, and this flux is cut by the conductor. So flux in one revolution, the conductor will experience the change in flux created by all the number of poles. So the total flux cut by the conductor is equals to number of poles multiplied by the flux created per pole. Okay, the total flux experienced or the total flux cut by the conductor is always equals to, okay, the total flux created by all the number of poles. Okay, so therefore flux cut by armature conductor in one revolution is equals to P into phi. Number of poles are P, general. It is 4 pole machine, so 4 into 5. If it is 2 pole, 2 into 5. If it is 6 pole, 6 into 5. Therefore, generally, it is number of poles into flux per pole. Okay? Now, what is the time taken for one revolution? Number of revolutions per second is 60 by n by 60. Time taken for one revolution, okay, is equals to 60 by n. It is equals to 60 by n. Why one revolution? Because whatever things happen in one revolution, it happens the same in all the revolutions. So I need not to check for the entire timeline. Whatever happens in one revolution, I should study everything. The same thing, everything that happens in one revolution will happen in all the revolutions. So if I find the EMF induced in one revolution, the same EMF is induced in all the revolutions. As long as the revolutions are existing, the EMF is induced. Okay? So, the EMF induced, the average value of EMF induced, okay, you can take the average value of EMF induced, okay, E is equals to, okay, the average value of EMF induced, E is equals to d phi by dt. Faraday's law will always give the average value. This already I have stated many a times. Okay, Faraday's law, this equation d phi by dt is always an average value of EMF induced. Now, what is d phi? D phi is change in flux, average value of EMF induced in one revolution. You can take in one revolution. So, d phi is change in flux in one revolution. Okay. And dt, time taken for one revolution. Okay, so please excuse me for my handwriting. I am not at comfortable with this whiteboard marker like I am comfortable on the board with chalk. Okay, that is creating lot of dust in the room, and I have small kids in my house, so they are getting cough because of this fine dust. So I have to come back to this whiteboard. Okay, since from yesterday the shops are open, I could purchase this. For these many days there were no shops open where I could find these things. Okay, fine. So now, what is change in flux? D phi is equals to final flux minus initial. See, change in everything is always final stage minus initial stage. Yes. So what is the flux cut after one revolution minus what was the flux cut before start of the revolution? So the flux cut by the conductor in one revolution is P phi. So final flux, total flux cut after one revolution is P phi. What is the initial flux cut before the revolution started? Zero. Obviously zero. Minus zero. Okay? This is equals to P phi. Okay? If you want, I will give more clarity. D phi. Change in flux in one revolution, that is flux cut after one revolution minus flux cut at start. This is obviously equals to P phi minus zero equals to P phi. So D phi is equals to P phi. What is time taken for one revolution? Dt is equals to, it is directly 60 by n. Therefore, average EMF induced or you can take average value of EMF induced in one revolution in one conductor. It is obviously in one conductor. In one conductor. Therefore, EMF induced in one conductor is equals to P phi divided by 60 by N, or is equals to P N by 60 into phi. P N by 60 into phi. This is average EMF in one conductor. This is average EMF in one conductor. Such, how many number of conductors I have? There are Z number of conductors in one phase. Therefore, EMF induced per phase. Therefore, EMF induced per, or average EMF induced, this has got a significance. Why every time I am calling average? Because later I have to convert it into RMS. So average EMF induced per phase is E is equals to, or EPH is equals to, I have phi P N by 60 into Z. Because Z are the number of conductors per phase, and all the conductors per phase are always connected in series. Okay, the winding is formed in the form of series connections. All the conductors are found, are connected in series. What do you mean by conductor? I have armature slots. Okay, so this is armature slot, and this armature slot is having some length. Okay, so whatever the conductor copper that is placed inside the slot is called a conductor. And if I have to form the entire winding, I should be connecting this conductor in back and front. Yes, you please refer the images that I have sent of stator. Okay, you see so many number of windings in that stator. I cannot show that because my mobile is on recording mode. Okay. Can you see the alternator image on the screen?
No, sir.
No. Sorry. Because it is in the same window. Okay, it's okay. Okay. So, if you see the winding, okay, you just refer the images. You see some copper coming out of the slot. Okay, some copper will be coming, bunch of the copper coming out of the slot in front as well as in the back. So those are the call end connections. So when I have to create a winding in the stator, conductor is my that part of the copper which is there in the slot. Whereas outside the slot, those are front and back connections. Though they form the conductor only, but in those front and back part of the copper, energy conversion will not occur. Okay, because they are not under the poles, they are away from the poles. Okay, so the number of conductors per phase are always connected in series, hence I will directly multiply it by Z. Okay, therefore for a sine wave, we know that for sine wave, because the EMF induced is sine wave, we already have derived it and justified it. For sine wave, form factor is equals to RMS value by average value is equals to 1.11 therefore RMS value of induced EMF E is equals to, capital letters always denote RMS values, E is equals to 1.11 into average value, that is EPH. So this is 1.11 into, what is that value, phi, what is PN by 60, sorry, let us take 1.11 into phi PN by 60 into Z. Okay, phi PN by 60 into Z. So what is we have F is equals to PN by 120, or PN is equals to 120 into F. Okay, so I can place I can replace PN in this equation by 120 F. Therefore E is equals to 1.11 into phi into F into 120 into Z divided by 60. So that will be E is equals to 2.22 F phi and Z volts. 2.22 F phi Z volts. Okay. These are the conductors. Now if I want to take the turns, okay, so number of turns are always equals to half the number of conductors, because if I want to form a turn, now this is one turn, this is one turn. To create this one turn, I need two conductors. This is one conductor, this is one more conductor. Okay, so number of turns are always equals to half the number of conductors. Okay. Number of turns per phase is equals to number of conductors per phase divided by 2. Therefore, T is equals to Z by 2. T is number of turns per phase. Okay. T is equal to Z by 2, or Z is equals to 2 into T. Number of conductors are always double the number of turns. Therefore, E is equals to 2.22 F phi into 2T, or 4.44 F phi into T volts. See, this is the same induced EMF equation of the transformer. In transformer also we got the same induced EMF, 4.44 F phi m into T1. That E1 was T1, E2 was T2. The induced EMF is always same, in case whether it is in a transformer or it is in alternator, okay, or in any coil. So this is the EMF induced. Equation, you can take equation 1, because no equation numbers we have put earlier. I will take this as equation 1. Equation 1 gives EMF induced in armature having concentrated full pitch coils. You should underline this, concentrated full pitch, not coils. You can take concentrated and full pitched winding. Okay, but we don't use concentrated and full pitch winding in practice. We use distributed and short pitch winding. What is that? We will look into that concept in our next class. Okay, in the next class, I will tell you what is distributed and short pitch or less than full pitch winding. Okay, so we'll end the session. Okay, and in next class, we will be dealing with the types of winding what we use in the armature and how the distributed and short pitch winding will affect the induced EMF, and how that I can consider in my EMF equation, we'll see in the next class. Okay, so thank you for joining, and excuse me for my son's voice at the end. Okay, so I simply cannot control. Okay, thank you.